This morning, Holy Spirit has laid on my heart a very unique word for me. Perhaps you've said this phrase on your way to work, on your way home from work, when you're behind grandma and grandpa driving 25 in a 65, or behind Chris and Joe, close your ears, behind one of those tractor trailers that absolutely love living in the fast lane going up the hill. Perhaps you've said something like, stay in your lane. Stay in your lane. And I was thinking this morning, in order to understand where we're going, you have to understand a little bit about what is going on in Scripture. In Hebrews chapter 11, it is what we call the Hall of Faith. Hebrews chapter 11 kind of gives you an overview of faith from the time of Abraham forward. As a matter of fact, it even goes back as far as Adam, Eve, Noah, Abraham, and comes all the way through. And it's men and women of faith who did not have the benefit of living on this side of the cross. Do you know that it is such a joy and a benefit for us to be living in such a time as this on this side of the cross? Because on that side of the cross, God would speak and they would hear and they would have to do what God has spoken. They had to be sold out. They had to have heard from God, because some of these folks, men and women from the past, would give the ultimate sacrifice and become martyrs. And when you understand Hebrews 11, Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, now faith is. And I don't have time to teach this or to preach this morning, but let me say this to you. There is no other kind of faith except for now. There is no such thing as coming faith or faith from the past. And when is now? A second ago is now a part of my history. A second before us is going to be a part of my future. But my now is affected by faith. There's only one kind of faith we can have, and that is now faith. That's why Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, now faith is. Now faith is. Is. And the rest of that verse goes on to describe what faith is. But you have to understand that we are living, this entire journey is a faith journey. Can you say amen? Amen. So this is all by faith. Someone says, well, I have a hard time with faith. I have a hard time taking things by faith. This is, God would say, without faith, it is impossible to please me. Because faith is literally saying what God has said when it's not so, until it becomes so. So anything in your life that is contrary to what God said about you, you have the authority, son of God and daughter of God, to open your mouth and say what God said. And when you open your mouth and say what God said, then it is God who watches over his word, and he is careful to perform it. Can you say amen? So why does it happen? So let's get to this. Let's get to, stand with me for the reading of God's word. If you have your Bibles, turn it to Hebrews chapter 12. We're just going to read the first two verses. And Hebrews chapter 12 says this, verse 1, therefore we also, now he's talking about, he had just told them in Hebrews 11 about all of the heroes or the hall of faith. Now he's connecting it. He's saying, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, Hebrews 11, the hall of faith, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Now, in your Bible, is that word "our" italicized? Probably is. If you see an italicized word in Scripture, it means it's not there in the original writings. They added it to make it make sense. But listen to how powerful this is. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of faith. Wow. Who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Father, thank you for your word. I know it is anointed. I ask you, Lord, that you would hide me behind the cross, that no one looks upon this stage and sees and hears from me today. But Father, they will see and they will hear directly from you. Holy Spirit, I ask you to take the words out of my mouth, and before it hits their ears, that you will cause understanding to happen, that you would transform it and make it make sense in the minds and the ears of those who are here today. We love you, Lord, and we praise you, and we thank you for who you are. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and this house shouted, amen and amen. And you may be seated this morning. Stay in your lane. Let me say this to you, that in order to understand where we are going, I'm going to have to break down a few words to you. The Bible says, therefore also, since we are surrounded by the great hall of faith, if you will, that we talked about in chapter 11, let us lay aside every weight. That word weight in the Greek means this. It means whatever is prominent, protuberance, or a burden. I love that word protuberance, mainly because I didn't know what it meant. Does anybody else struggle with that one? So I had to look it up. And protuberance is, what are you thinking about right now? What's on the front of your mind right now? What are the chores? What are the things, the activities, the people, the circumstances, the stuff you are dealing with right now? What is prominent in your thinking? What is on the front of your mind that is causing a burden in your life? That's what the word weight is. That is what you are thinking about. And when you look at the word sin, it says this. Sin is to miss the mark and to wander from God's law or to violate God's law. If you think about that thing long enough that is outside of the realms of God's way of doing things, when you think about it long enough and it stays on the front of your mind long enough, we know in biblical terminology, it is called an iniquity. An iniquity is a thought process that causes you to lean away from the things of God. And if an iniquity is on the front of your mind and it is at the top of your mind and what you are thinking about, an iniquity, when thought about long enough, produces action that causes sin. And sin is the manifestation of a thought process that is leading you away from the things of God. For example, it is a sin to kill somebody. You just don't kill somebody. You think about it. And a lot of these things, it's called premeditated murder. So if you're going to step outside the box, you're going to have to think about it. Well, how am I going to do it? How can I do it and get by with it? How can I make it look like this? And how can I do that? So sin, when you're thinking sinful things, sin always starts with a thought. A prominent thought that causes you to have things on the top of your mind that you are thinking about. And when those things are things that tilt you away from the things of God, the fruit of that thought seed is sin. Sin is missing the mark. Sin is doing things outside of God's way of doing things for you. How many of you know that when you are not a Christian, sin is your master? The devil is in control of you. You only have two masters. It's either God or the devil. And if you do not know God, if you do not know Jesus, have a personal relationship with Jesus, and have experienced the forgiveness and the grace and the love of God in your life, then you are still serving the master of sin. But I've got good news for you today. You don't have to be a slave to sin any longer. As a matter of fact, when you accept Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life, your Bible gloriously declares that sin no longer has a hold on you. It is no longer your master. But glory to God, Jesus already took care of that, and he rendered sin useless on the life of a believer. He rendered the devil powerless against you, and that ought to bring an amen right now. Amen and amen. Praise God. So we've got these weights. We've got these things on our mind that calls us to lean away. Or let me keep it in context with the sermon. Causes us to cross out of our lane into somebody else's. Why? Because we are thinking about stuff. We're listening to stuff that causes us not to walk in the fullness of God's design for our life. Can I share a story with you? When I sang Southern gospel music, our radio promoter made a comment. It was innocent enough, but it was just a passing comment. We were thinking about a song that the Bates family had recorded that I was singing lead on. And our radio promoter said, Tony's voice is so unique that his Southern gospel is not Southern enough, and his country's not country enough, so we don't think we ought to go with this song to radio because his Southern's not Southern and his country's not country, and we think it might confuse the radio programmer. Innocent enough, I get it. It was a business decision. But do you know that stuck to me? Something got inside of my head that my Southern wasn't Southern and my country's not country. My God, what am I doing out here? Before long, I was writing songs at that time that I could hear myself singing. I was writing songs. I was like, man, I could tear this thing up. Boy, it'd be great if I... And then all of a sudden, everything I started doing, I started approaching from a defensive perspective because I had decided that somebody spoke something over me that I believed. My Southern wasn't Southern and my country's not country. And so because I believed it, it started changing my behavior. And when my behavior changed, it affected my songwriting. It affected my musicianship. It affected my confidence. It affected it. Why? What happened? Because I had begun to cross into another lane that did not belong to me. I started functioning as something else that wasn't me because I was trying to conform to an image that somebody had of me. So I was trying to let my Southern gospel be more Southern gospel. And then when I was in that country market, I was trying to get that country market to be more country. And I was trying, and I was a madman because I couldn't please everybody all the time. I'd either get in this lane and that make somebody happy, but this lane didn't, or this lane over here didn't make anybody happy. I couldn't focus and stay in my lane because I was listening to people outside of my lane in other areas. Now watch, this didn't happen accidentally. Your Bible says that it talks about in verse 1, it says, lay aside every weight, every thought process that produces an action that is contrary to God's way, which so easily ensnares. This is verse 1. Ensnares. Now, I looked at the word ensnares. In the King James Version, it says beset. That word beset is this. It is skillfully surrounding. What? Now, wait a minute. I'm dealing with a mindset that has attacked me by design. The devil knew what would get my attention, so he skillfully surrounded my thoughts with things that I would think about and it would affect me. You may not can relate. If you've never struggled with drugs, you might can never relate to what it's like to be addicted to drugs. That's why the devil won't tempt you with drugs, because he's not skillfully surrounding you with something that don't work. That's why you keep dealing. You keep calling it a cycle. You keep talking about this, and this keeps popping up. Anybody in the room, and maybe I'm the only one, baby girl. Maybe I'm the only one that stuff just keeps popping up over time. I mean, it's like cycles, and it's like, man, I just dealt with that, and here I am dealing with that again, and I get this fixed, and something else pops up, and then I get that fixed, and something else pops up, and it's all cyclical. It is skillfully surrounding us because the goal of the enemy is to get your mind off of your lane and into somebody else's lane so that you can run a race that somebody else is trying to dictate for you. It's all by design. And we get so distracted, that we don't even see it as a skillful surrounding of the enemy. You know, you can pretty much attribute all the junk you're dealing with to a thought process. You can. Oh, I don't feel good. That might be what your body says, but your Bible says you are healed. See, that jacks people up because I just took away all your excuse. What's your confession? It's good, isn't it? Getting quiet. Why? Because I'm trying to encourage you. God sent you a traffic cop today to let you. I'm not trying to manage your life. I'm just trying to help you stay in your lane. I'm just trying to help you. It says, and we run this race. This word run. I love this run because in the Greek, you know what it means? Run. But if you look a little deeper, it is a Greek metaphor that means this. Those who incur extreme peril, that is trouble. That is stuff going on. Anybody ever dealt with extreme stuff in your life? So it's talking about those who incur extreme peril, which it requires the exertion of all of one's energy to overcome it. It means determination. Do you know that you're going to have to determine in your heart that you will not be a victim anymore, that you are the victor in every area of your life? And you're going to have to devote some time to that. Somebody said, well, I wish I knew the Bible like pastors do. I love Miss V's class. Oh, I wish I could just spend and have all that Bible knowledge. Well, you know what? You can. The problem is you haven't been determined enough to get past the distractions. Because if you really wanted it, guess what you would do? You do it. Because I'm going to break it down for you. Are you ready? If you're taking notes, this would be a great time for you to stop and take notes. People do what they want to do. Just write that one down, circle it, underline it. Put your name in it. Just Tony does what Tony wants to do. Say it with me. Not Tony. Put your name there. Because I saw y'all starting to rise up. Tony does. But think about it, don't you? And so, if the voices get to you long enough, and you start being distracted long enough, you get out of your lane. And then you start trying to run a race that's not designed for you. Do you know this thing is simple when you're doing what you're supposed to do? The enemy's constantly trying to skillfully surround you with thoughts and ideas and conflicts and people. That's how it works. I got to share this story. I've got a friend of mine who lives in Ohio. Every year we go on a fishing trip to South Carolina. I didn't get to go last year, the year before, he was sitting on the back of my boat, and he knows I'm a pastor of a church. He doesn't go to church anywhere. And he knows I'm a pastor of a church. And he says, so you pastor, do you? I said, yeah. He said, how big is your church? I said, oh, we got a few folks coming, you know. I'm not that guy that, you know, 1,000 people, evangelistically speaking. I'm not that guy. I said, well, God's been good to us, man. We've seen it grow from 3 people, and we've got a few more than that now. We have as many ministries going out of our church as we do people who used to attend. God's just been real good to us. I said, where do you go to church? He said, I don't go to church. Sunday is my yard work day. And he said, if I don't do it on Sunday, it doesn't get done. Oddly enough, we're having this conversation at 6:30 in the morning on Sunday morning on the back of my boat. So the generous smart aleck that I tend to be from time to time, the next question out of my mouth was, well, who's cutting your grass today? He got real quiet. Come on now. Who's cutting your grass today? It's my only day off, Pastor. I don't want to drive 30 minutes, 40 minutes to church and then be there for 2 hours. That praise team sings too long to start with. And pastor never gets to the point. I just wish he'd get to the point. Oh, you didn't know I was reading your mail? Trying to get you to stay in your lane. Because when you're in your lane, there's an anointing, there's a flow that is connected to obedience. So how do we get rid of all these distractions? How do we get rid of this and that and this and that and all this stuff? And the devil is skillfully surrounding us with enough distraction that if it was up to him, you would never crack a Bible open. You wouldn't spend 2 minutes in prayer. You wouldn't worship God on your own if it was up to him. Why? Because his job, he is so good at skillfully surrounding you with things contrary to God. God's word, that if you don't get determined in your mind to run this race with some endurance to make sure that your determination is greater than the plan against you, we got to get hungrier for the things of God than we are for the things we're eating from the enemy right now. Amen. Amen. So we run. So we get some determination. I love this. How do we get rid of all the distractions? Three words. Look at this. Looking unto Jesus. Now that's the start of verse 2, but I'm going to preach for a while. Is that all right? Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Say that with me. Looking unto to Jesus. Had a guy call me one time. He brought me to his house. He said, Pastor, I'd like to talk to you because I have some theology I'd like to talk to you about. And I'm sure that when we're finished with this conversation, you'll see things from my perspective. I said, man, I love that. The Bible's not up for debate. So if you're calling me for a debate, that ain't going to happen. But if you'd like to have a discussion, we can do that. And when I get there, he had it all lined out. How I was supposed to be following Matthew and Mark and Luke and John. And then I was supposed to be following the example of Paul. And I was supposed to be following all the examples. And those are great guidelines. But let me just tell you something. I have decided as a minister and as a ministry, I love learning from those fathers of the church who have gone before me. But I think I'll go ahead and teach what they've been teaching. I think I'll just go ahead and look unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. And when I took him back to Jesus and he's like, yeah, but. There is no yeah, but. It is looking unto Jesus. If you're outside of your box, if you're outside of your lane and you're dealing with some stuff, just look unto Jesus. This is so simple, but it's not easy because you got to make that happen. You got to choose to look at Jesus. The enemy is really good at surrounding you with the pity party folks, the folks who love celebrating your failures. You know, I knew you couldn't live it. I knew you couldn't stay clean. Come on, man. I knew you. Come on. You should never married that person anyway. I knew it was going to fail from the beginning. I'm preaching better than your amen. Is my mic on, Kyle? I'm not. And so we start looking at circumstances. We start looking at finances. We start looking at stuff. And we start weaving. I can always tell when I'm behind a driver been on the road a while because they start weaving. Anybody ever just get tired? You know how you know you're getting tired? Oh, I love praise and worship. I love it, I love it, I love it. Who would tie my bow tie and we can huck and buck and flip and flop and do all that stuff and that's great. Do you know how you can tell you're getting tired? Because you start weaving. You start dabbling in stuff that you would have never dabbled in if you was in your right mind. This is good preaching. I promise it is. We live in a culture today, man, where if it feels good, do it. It's even slipping into the church. Thank God for grace. Yay! Hey, I'm a grace preacher. Don't get me wrong. And it's got to be hyper grace that saved us. But let me tell you, I'm not that guy that says it's okay for you to go out and sin and just do whatever you want because thank God for grace. I'm the guy that's telling you grace gives you eyeballs to see sin for what it is and it'll help you rise above it. Thank God for grace because grace goes before us. The mercy of God is there for us when we make a mistake. The grace of God helps us identify it for what it is. It is a distraction designed to cause us to weave and it's designed to get us out of our lane. But I came today to tell you grace in its proper use will keep you in your lane. Amen. Now, I love this. Look at verse 2 again. This is what you and I do. Actually, let's go looking unto Jesus. This is what I know. You and I, as human nature, are constantly comparing ourselves to somebody else. I remember early on when we had a couple of ministers in our church, I'd say, hey, I'm going out of town. Would you mind preaching for me Sunday morning? Here's their response. Pastor, I can't preach like you. There ain't no way I can sing like you. I can't do it like, I'm not as, you got, and they were automatically comparing themselves with me. Now, it's all human nature because as I was getting ready to minister with Pastor John Hagee, I did the same thing. I had a panic attack backstage. I was like, my God, I'm about ready to minister with Pastor John. John Hagee, this guy's known all over the world. What am I doing here? One of these things ain't like the other. And I was singing all these songs to myself. I was like, man, I don't qualify. There's no initials behind my name. There's no fancy stuff about me. And then I called Kara. Kara said, baby, this is an attack from the devil. And she said, I rebuke that attack. You are anointed to be at the place you are. And you need to go and do what you've been anointed to do. I tell you what, I started rising up. I stopped comparing myself with somebody else. Because guess what? Always going to be somebody better. And I'm always going to be better than somebody else. It never stops. This is what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. For we dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves. But they, measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves, are not wise. Let me read you the Amplified version of what he just said. I love this. We do not, go to the Amplified version. I'll wait on you. Because this is powerful. If you're taking pictures of the screen, this would be the one you take a picture of. Watch this. We do not have the audacity to put ourselves in the same class or compare ourselves with some who supply testimonials to commend themselves when they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they lack wisdom and behave like fools. Isn't that powerful? So let me tell you something in love. Stop comparing yourself to everybody else. There's only one of you. You're the best you God ever made, and he's never going to make another you. You have been created with a purpose, on purpose. Stay in your lane. Amen. Now watch. Watch this. So you're looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of God. You have to understand something. In the Roman times, crucifixion was the absolute worst and shameful death you could ever have. As a matter of fact, it was so shameful and such a curse to be crucified that it was against the law for Roman citizens to be crucified. I didn't realize that until this week. That's how shameful it was to be crucified. Now watch this. We sing the old rugged cross and we sing all the songs about the cross. We've done a really good job of westernizing the cross, and we've sang so much about the cross. We even wear cross earrings and cross necklaces, and we got the cross hanging up on our sun visors, and we've got the cross bumper sticker, and it's all about the cross. It's all about the cross. It's all about, and we have lost the significance of what Jesus did. That's why he said it again right here. He said, looking unto Jesus, the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame that was connected to the cross. And he has sat down at the right hand of God. Why do we look at Jesus while we're running this race? Because Jesus finished his race, because a high priest could not sit down in the presence of God unless the work was done. Jesus endured the cross, despising the shame, and when he got back home to where daddy was, our high priest sat down. If you're going to compare yourself to anybody, look unto Jesus. Woo! Because he's already done it. He's already finished it. He did it. He did it. If you're going to compare yourself to anybody, I dare you start comparing yourself to Jesus. Well, nobody can compete with that. I beg to differ. Let me tell you something. In the sight of God, by the blood of Jesus, we have been made perfect in the sight of God. What's that word mean? That word perfect is not without flaws. It means finished. The blood of Jesus has finished us, and we are already seated in heavenly places with God. God sees us from where we are there, not from where we are here. That's a powerful perspective because of the blood of Jesus. Well, what's that old song? He's still working on me. Makes me what I ought to be. It took him just a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth and Jupiter and Mars. How loving and patient he must be, because he's still working on me. We sing that song, we wear it like a badge of honor. Oh, I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. I'm going to make mistakes. Would you just knock it off? The devil has skillfully put a thought in your head that justifies your lack of faith in God by calling you a sinner, and you buy into it. You are no longer a sinner. I gloriously declare that you have been made a new creation in Christ Jesus. The former things have passed away, and you have become new. And if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, let me tell you, I don't care how many times you get high, how many times you get drunk, how many times you go out and just live it up and having a great time, it ain't ever going to compare to a Holy Ghost trip and getting drunk on that holy wine and having that moment with God where it's just you and him all alone, and you can remember it tomorrow. When's the last time you got drunk on the Spirit and could hardly stand up? Powerful, isn't it? It's going to make you look like a fool. I shared this with the Bible study folks Wednesday night. I was in a big old Southern Baptist church in Fredericksburg, Virginia, releasing the kingdom of God. I've got a video series out there. If you don't have it, you need to get it. It's called Thy Kingdom Come. God gave me a revelation in March of 2012 that literally transformed my marriage, it transformed my ministry, transformed my finances, transformed my health, it transformed everything in my life. Thy Kingdom Come. I started teaching this message out on the road called Thy Kingdom Come with the Thy Kingdom Come conferences. The last night of that conference, we always lay hands on people and watch the miraculous manifest right in front of us. It's the way it is. It was signs and wonders following the truth that had been preached. Can you say amen? And when we got in there, that old Baptist preacher, come Wednesday night, there's a long story I don't have time to tell you, but he was amazed that the crowd just kept coming back Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, all these people getting healed and delivered. One of those Baptist folks that served on his board, we laid hands on them and they did one of these. Baptist folks. And the preacher leaned over me and said, "What was that?" That was the body trying to experience or express a manifestation of Holy Spirit. Sometimes you just cry. Sometimes you huck and buck. Sometimes you jerk like someone's knocking you out of the way. Sometimes you, I don't like that word slain in the spirit. That's not what it is. It's the most peaceful place on the earth. When you get down into that, and you get into that realm where your body just lets go and you just rest. And Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down. It's the most peaceful place on earth. Someone said, I don't believe in that. It's probably why you're not sleeping at night. I get into that realm every night. I ask him to put me there. And it's peaceful. I wake up the next day charging hell with a water gun. You think I'm crazy? If you do, it's okay, because I'm just going to stay in my lane. Let me read you Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 in the Amplified version of the Bible. Watch. Looking away from all that will distract us and focusing our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of faith, the first incentive for our belief and the one who brings our faith to maturity, who for the joy of accomplishing the goal set before him endured the cross, disregarding the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, revealing his deity, his authority, and the completion of his work. Powerful, isn't it? So if you're distracted, I have a question for you. It's real simple. It's about looking unto Jesus. Here's my question. Who are you looking at and listening to? Who are you looking at and listening to? Who are you looking at and listening to? Huh? Amen. It's okay. It's almost over, son. Who are you looking at and listening to? I'm just going to be real still. You can come, Ralph, if you'd like. Who are you looking at and who are you listening to? If you got people around you who tolerate you, you need to ditch that crowd and put some people around you who celebrate you. You don't have to be the most popular. I remember kids listen to me. When I was in high school, I ain't going to tell you when. Me and my brother, we prayed before every football game and before every baseball game. That's back when you could. And they gathered the whole team around and they knew that. The coaches knew that me and my brother were Christians. We started the local chapter of Fellowship of Christian Athletes in our school, FCA. Started off with me and my brother and a teacher in a school that if you said the word Jesus, it could start a fight. I'm talking it's redneck. We were so far back in the sticks, you had to go towards town to go hunting. You understand what I'm talking about? We were piping in sunshine every day from somewhere. And so we started this Bible club. It was a local chapter of FCA. We did not start FCA. It was a local chapter of FCA. And we started me and my brother and a teacher. And so during these sporting events, we'd gather around and the coach would say, Tony or Tim, you want to say a word of prayer for us? And we'd always pray for protection of our players. I'm going to tell you, if you're praying for the Bengals to beat Pittsburgh today, God's not listening to that prayer. It'll be obvious. I'm a Bengals fan, and there's Steelers fans in the room. You will probably win. But so we didn't pray, God, help us beat so-and-so. We prayed for safety and divine protection of our players and all that. The kids would laugh at me and my brother because we would carry a Bible with us as part of our textbooks. And during study halls or whatever, we just go through it. And all the kids called us preacher boys, pointing fingers. Prom night was tough for us because everybody was getting hammered and trying to get lucky. You know how it is. Talking about the after parties, and we're not going to invite those Bates boys. They'll try to get us all saved. We want to get hammered. We want to do stupid. Pete Howe, who was our star running back in football, had a full ride to college on an athletic scholarship and an academic scholarship. Was jogging one morning in the fog, did not see the car, crossed the road, got hit square. His head hit the windshield and his head crushed the pavement. And guess who all those kids and Pete's mom and daddy called? The preachers. Pete had been in the hospital for about 3 days and they couldn't get him to respond. His wife was there. He wasn't responding to anything. He was in a coma, massive brain damage. They said he would probably never talk or walk ever again. So I get the call. That was back before cell phone days. And I get the call at my house. It's about 11 o'clock at night. And if you call my house at 11 o'clock at night, you better be dead or dying. And they said, Tony Petey's pretty bad. Can you come? It was his mom and dad. He's not responding to his wife. He's not responding to his friends. So I got in my car and I drove from Roanoke, Virginia, where I was living at the time, all the way to Columbus, Ohio. Straight shot, didn't stop. And when I walked in there, all the jocks were in there. All the popular kids. Let me tell you something, man. Popularity without Jesus is a waste of time. I don't care how popular you are. If you don't know how to talk to God, you're done. Me and my brother, we were athletes. I guess you'd call us jocks. We was just different. We was weird. We're the kids you make fun of. As soon as I walked in, the room cleared. Pete's mom and dad left. His wife left. It's just me and Pete. My heart broke. And I went over and I grabbed Petey by his left hand. And when I did that, a tear came out of my eye, ran down my nose, and it hit him on his left hand. And he went. It's the first response. I was like, my God. And I said, Petey, if they called me Lefty growing up. I was a left-handed pitcher with one finger. I said, Petey, it's Lefty. Tears running down my face, and I said, I love you, buddy. Don't know if you can hear me or not, but I'm going to pray over you. And I just started praying like my buddy was dying, because I wasn't for sure, and I wasn't praying to myself. Honey, let me tell you something. If you're going to shape the atmosphere, you're going to have to learn to let it out of your mouth. Well, I just sit here and pray to myself. Devil don't know what you're thinking. So I leaned down and I began to pray and I said, Father, thank you. And I don't remember everything I said. Tears rolling down my face and it was sprinkled on his arm. And I wish I could say that immediately Pete woke up and he was showed up for the game Saturday. Didn't happen that way. A week goes by and he comes out of coma. He knows who his mom is. He knows who his dad is. He knows who his wife is. He's speaking, but his speech is incredibly slurred. There's a part in his brain that the swelling hadn't gone down, but he's starting to speak, and there's no paralysis. He's pointing and moving in his legs. And about a year and a half goes by, and I'm in a little church in West Portsmouth, Ohio, doing a concert. Guess who walked in the back door? And Petey got up on the bus with me and he said, I got a question for you. I said, okay. He said, you come see me when I was in the hospital. I said, I did. He said, you prayed for me, didn't you? I said, man, I did. He said, I felt every tear that hit my arm. And he said, I heard every word. And he said, I knew I couldn't respond, but the day you were there, I gave my heart and life to Jesus. Right there. He said, that's why I'm here now, because I'm telling people all about the saving grace of God, that he came to me when I couldn't get to him. Come on, baby, I'm encouraging you to stay in your lane. You ain't gonna do it like somebody else. Stay in your lane. I'm looking to Jesus. Jesus got outside the temple. And he met people in the marketplace. And he met people in the street. And he met Samaritan women at a well that he was never supposed to even have contact with them. It was against the culture for Jesus, a Jew, to talk to a Samaritan, much less a Samaritan woman. Jesus had an appointment to be there. She had reservations about being there. He had a reservation to be there. Jesus got out of the box, but he stayed in his lane, and he was true to who God called him to be. Let me tell you something, young people. It ain't going to be popular right now. They may not like you right now, but that's okay. There's coming a day when the rubber meets the road. You're going to be one of those people where they say, she knows God. He knows God. We got to get in touch with him. And when the rubber meets the road and you're in the life of a point of crisis in your life, it's not about you knowing a pastor. You need to know God so that you can talk to God on your own behalf and stay in your lane and speak to those things that be not as though they were and take authority and dominion. Who are you listening to? What are you looking at that is a distraction causing you to sway? Are you tired? Stay in your lane. To this day, anytime I'm within driving distance, Petey can't drive, but he's talking really good. We'll tell you how this works. I may have him here. He got real fat. Now this guy looked like Superman. Boom. He got real fat. 5-6 chins. He'd tell me, he said, man, I got more chins than a Chinese phone book, you know. Y'all will get that one on the way home. God gave him an all-natural homeopathic way to lose weight in a dream. Pete gets disability insurance. That's his income. He wrote a book, and you can tell he wrote it because he didn't spell check nothing. He wrote it like he talks. Misspelled words, broken ideas and concepts, but it's Pete's book on how to get fit naturally and homeopathically. And do you know, if you was to look at him now, he looks like he belongs on the cover of Muscle magazine. God took somebody the devil tried to snuff out. Just like you, you're not dead yet, honey. That's why you're here. Well, I should be dead, but you're not. You need Jesus. Stay in your lane. Every head bowed and every eye closed just for a moment. Are you in this room today and you don't know Jesus? I'm going to tell you, man, until you actually take that exit, life in the fast lane never stops for you. You say, Pastor, I don't know Jesus as my Lord and Savior, but I'd sure like to. Is that you today? Would you just slip your hand up? Let me see. Is there one? I don't know Jesus, but boy, I'd like to. What a great Christmas gift to give yourself. Is that you? Is there one? Well, Pastor, I don't know if I'd go say all that. I don't know Jesus. I may not come to church, but I know who Jesus is. Yeah, I'm talking about a relationship with God. Intimate relationship. Does he know you? Is there one in this room that says, Pastor, yes. I can honestly say that if I'm honest about this, I've been weaving a little from left to right. I've been kind of having trouble staying in my lane. Is that you today? Would you just slip your hand up? Let me see. Is there one? I'm dealing with some stuff. Sometimes I have a tendency to swerve a little. Is that you? Thank you. Is there another? Quickly. Yeah. Just be honest. We all do this. We all struggle with stuff. Say this with me. Say, Heavenly Father. All of us pray together. Say, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, forgive me for paying attention to the distractions. Father, I repent, or I turn away from all of those things that keep me from being all you created me to be, from being all you created me to be. And right now, Father, I choose you. I'm going to look to you. I'm going to look to you. I'm going to look to you as my example. in life, in business, in ministry. From this moment on, I rebuke every distraction. I reject every report. I come against and reverse every curse. And I release the manifestation of God's fullness in my life. I am who He says I am. I can do everything He says I can do. Now say this with me. I am a child of God. I hear His voice. I operate in His authority. And I walk in His favor. To say it again, I am a child of God. I hear His voice. I operate in His authority. And I walk in His favor. Look at me. Stay in your lane. Praise God. Isn't this good? Isn't this good? What a word.